Good morning. Good morning. It's good to see you all this morning. A little brisk morning here. Fall has come upon us, finally. It was good little rain. It's good to see you all. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day, and we thank you for this time we could come and meet together and worship you and sing songs of praise and hear a message from your word and remember the sacrifice that you made for us, that we could be reconciled to you. God, we'd ask that you'd be with us in our worship, be with us as we go through our daily lives, help us to carry Christ with us everywhere we go, and show the world the light that is in us. God, be with our country and be with our leaders at this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand and sing, shall we?
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, also highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for our sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Now I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go, anywhere he leads me in this world below. Anywhere without him dearest joys would fade, anywhere with Jesus I am not afraid. Anywhere, anywhere fear I cannot know, anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere with Jesus I am not alone. Other friends may fail me, he is still my own. Though his hand may lead me over drearest ways, anywhere with Jesus is a house of praise. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere with Jesus over land and sea, telling souls in darkness of salvation free. Ready as he summons me to go or stay, anywhere with Jesus when he points the way. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere with Jesus I can go to sleep, when the darkening shadows round about me creep, knowing I shall wake and never more to roam. Anywhere with Jesus will be home, sweet home. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go.
I've only led this song a couple times, and I like to do it a little bit more than twice as fast as you might be used to if you used to sing this song a lot a long time ago. So be ready for that.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear, can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for those who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go, never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Please be seated.
It's a pretty song. I like that song. I think sometimes it's easy to sing. It's easy to read words, see words, say words. Sometimes I wonder, though, if it really touches us. What does it mean to ask God to purify our hearts? Does my heart need purifying? Let's pray. Dear God, I pray that we humbly approach You and in realization that we in fact do need our hearts to be purified. There's so much that goes on inside of us, and we let the world affect us in so many different ways, and sometimes that's not good. Sometimes it seeps into our brain and inhabits our thoughts, even though we can call ourselves Your people, call ourselves Christians, sometimes we don't think Christian things. God, we just pray that You would purify our hearts. Make us see You, even in times of struggle, and even in times of sickness, in times of stress. I just pray that we can look up and see You. and that you will guide our hearts, guide our words, guide our minds. And God, we thank you for your wisdom in all things. Thank you for the plan that you put out to restore us unto you, to have your son leave your side and come to earth and live as a man and to face all the struggles and things that we do, but most of all to possibly turn his back on you and to take the credit for things. But God, we're blessed that he was resisted that temptation that Satan put before him, and he decided that, made a choice to be obedient, to bend his will to yours, to bend his ideas of how things should go to yours. And in the end, taking that walk even to the cross where he died, carrying the weight of the sins of the world. God, thank you for that. Thank you for his willingness. Thank you for that blessing, God. And I pray as we remember this act, this time, that we will be humbled by it and we will strive to be like Jesus in our own lives, to submit our wills unto you and to your ways. God, please purify our hearts. Thank you for this bread to remind us of Christ's body that was broken for us. And it's his name we pray. Amen. Let's pray again. God, again, we approach you and we thank you for this simple reminder of Jesus' sacrifice, the blood that he shed on the cross for us. Thank you for this cup. Thank you for the simple reminder. It doesn't require a lot of money and a lot of extravagance to provide this and have this in our lives, Lord. Thank you for that. Thank you again for Jesus and the way he walked in obedience to you, Lord. Thank you again. And it's his name we pray. Amen. It's an interesting picture. Electric lights. Anyways, this time I just want to remind you that you can give, several ways to give. There's a plate in the back you can give here at church. You can put a check in the mail, and we even are in the 21st century and that you can give online with the use of a debit card or a bank account. It's pretty cool. And for all those that you've given, everybody here's been generous even through these times, And I want to thank you for all that. It truly is a blessing. Would you pray with me? God, thank you for all the gifts you've given us. Thank you for the blessings even of this place we get to live. This, even though it's a little chilly this morning, it's not like some of the places. I know I have a son that lives in Oklahoma, and he's been without electricity for days on end. And I just thank you that we get to live in a wonderful place like this, God. Thank you. For this building that we can get in and out of the cold and worship you. And thank you for the technology that allows us to transmit into the homes of those that can't get out, Lord. Thank you for all that, and thank you for the blessings of life itself, Lord. I just pray that you would bless the offering that's given. May it be used to your glory. And we ask this through Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Today's scripture reading is Matthew 5, verses 10 through 12, and 17 through 20. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And 17, Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah. Right? Good morning. I tell you. When you were a kid, did you ever fall asleep in class? Did you ever, like in the lab, you know, one of those science classes where they had tables in the back, did you ever crawl up on top of them and just go to sleep the whole way through class? No? Okay. Maybe it was just me. Anyways, sometimes, you know, it's just better to sleep through class. Some people think that of church. I don't know. You know, maybe you've reached an age and a stage at your life, in your life, that, you know, it just doesn't matter anymore. There's not so much meaning. Life's kind of sad, and you just don't care. You know, sometimes that happens when you're a teen. Sometimes it happens when you're 80. Sometimes it takes till you're 90. Sometimes you see death coming and you're like, well, whatever. You know, I just don't care. I don't think that's most of you here today. But some people feel the need to, you know, drink away their problems or medicate in some other way. They're just finding a way to deal with the doldrums of life. Meh, right? It's indifference. Yeah. You use meh when you just don't care. You use it when, you know, whatever. And the truth is that there's a lot of times when, you know, somebody invites you to a party down at the lake and you're like, well, whatever. It's lame. I don't know if I really want to go or not go. And you might go to the party and, you know, get all dressed up, and then you walk in the water and you just stand there and it's kind of boring. And you go home, but, you know, it's like everything's just a wet blanket or wet clothes, and it just doesn't matter. And you say, what's the point? Life is stupid. Nothing makes sense. My team didn't win. My group fell apart. I failed my paper. My house, I have to clean it every day. It's just annoying. Just hate life. And so today we're going to talk about Acedia. It's the fancy way to say apathy. It's the old-timey way to talk about when you just don't care. It just doesn't matter. And it is a vice. It's the moment in the noon time, just after lunch, when you're like, I might as well just take a nap. What's it matter? I can just go ahead and siestas are good. Naps are good. I'll just go ahead and rest. And you recognize that you just don't care. Life is just kind of pathetic. You're not, but you know life is. So why bother? Some people would say you're a work in progress, but you've decided that it's okay if you buffer forever. Like, it's never going to download. Life is just sad. And you might think, but I want to care. Okay, so that's what the sermon's about this morning. We're going to walk through the ideas of if you wanted to care, how would this work? And the truth is, many of you, I don't know about you, but I mean like you generically in the whole world, people that go to church, here's what we do sometimes. This might fit. If it's too close to home, you know, you didn't bring anything except for maybe the book beside you could throw at me or your used communion cup, but you probably couldn't get it that far anyways because you're out of energy. So it's okay. But here's the thing. You know, you want to care. You might want to care, but the truth is, sometimes we wake up in the morning, we say, oh, it's Sunday again. If I don't go to church, people will call, they'll bother me. So I guess I'll put my clothes on, I'll get there, I'll do the thing I'm supposed to do, I'll say hi to people, and then I'll go home. But the truth is, if you're online, you don't even have to do that anymore, huh? You can just stay home. And you can sleep, or you might not even be watching this now, you can watch it later. And then if it doesn't fit, you'll just be like, man, he's dull and depressing and sad today, I'm just going to click, turn him off. I don't want to hear this, I don't need this. I might want to care, but I don't have to anymore. I can just sit at home. I mean, everything's delivered. Even McDonald's delivers now, you know? I mean, come on. You don't have to even hardly get out of bed. I mean, you might have to occasionally, but that's why they make adult diapers, right? And now, here's the other side of this. All some people do now is they watch. They watch and they scroll. And some people, they do both at the same time. It's called doom scrolling. Right? You just keep scrolling on your social media, the ever-present feed that never ends. You can't get to the end of it. You just keep going and going and going and going. And then you watch movies, and you watch at the same time as you doom scroll because the movie isn't as good as they used to be. Because they're just, well, you know, I mean, you've watched all the really exciting stuff, and now all that's left over is reruns of Seinfeld and stuff like that. And it's like, Seinfeld's a show about this. Nah. Right? And I mean, Seinfeld, pathetic. So if I wanted to care, how would I care? Well, first off, there's this thing called binge clock. Have you heard of it? Nobody? I just found it. It's amazing. If you're thinking, I don't really care, and I think I'll just go watch all of Seinfeld, it will tell you that it will take you 90.5 hours nonstop. That is 3 days and 18 hours and 30 minutes of continuous watching. And some people are like, okay, well, I've watched all of Seinfeld. I guess I'll start again. Right? It's a show about nothing and about meh. And about, well, if I wanted to care, what would that look like, right? And now at the same time, some people say, well, I want to be spiritual. I really do. I want to be godly. I want to follow Jesus. But, you know, the Bible's a really thick book. And it would just take so long to understand this, to read this. But I guess 90 hours of watching Seinfeld, that's worth it. Right? They say if you only spend 15 minutes a day, you could read through the whole Bible in a year. And here's the other, you don't even have to read it anymore. You can just click the listen button and they'll read it to you. Isn't that amazing? But that's still too hard because it's the Bible and it's kind of, you know, for some people it's really meh on meh. It's like boring on boring. Okay, so Friends, if you wanted to watch that show, that would take 5 days and 1 hour. Big Bang Theory, for most of the folks in the room, you probably aren't excited about that, but there are some people that are. And Big Bang Theory is like one of the most popular TV shows. You know how long it would take to watch all of that? 5 days and 19 hours and 30 minutes continuously. That's just a long time to watch a show, isn't it? Now think about that. If you've watched any show, how many of you were fans of Bonanza back in the day? Anybody? Yeah, and if you watched all of that, do you know how many days that would take? 17 days. 23 hours. So basically 18 full days of 20, I mean, you're just nonstop. You are not allowed to get up and go, well, if you go to the bathroom, you know. But here's the thing, like, we ask these questions of, well, what would it take to get me off the couch and to do anything? I mean, really, at this point, many people are at home going, this is just, I don't want to get up. I mean, we've been sitting for so long now, it's kind of like that movie. Oh, what was the name of that movie? The little happy Wall-E, thank you. I knew somebody would just have it. I didn't even have to describe it because it's so true. Wall-E, the little happy guy that comes back to Earth, and he's a robot, and he surveys the planet to see if there's any life possible here and if there's anything good. and he finds one tiny little plant. And the issue is that at the beginning of the movie, everybody was just sitting around watching TV and drinking big drinks, right? And they got so large, and they used up all the resources of the planet that they had to leave because it was just full of garbage, and Wall-E was sent back to kind of clean it up and get it going again and to get people able to return. And it was just crazy that people had to get up off their recliner that moved everywhere and get back to living. And I think that's where we're at today in some ways. So what's my motivation? Enough of the sad doldrums. How do I do this? Well, here's the difficulty. If you're a perfectionist like me or a recovering perfectionist, you will struggle to get off the couch for these reasons. It might not go well. And all of us can say that right now, can't we? Like, 2020 is the year that keeps giving or taking. And it's not fun. So many awkward things have happened, right? And so here's the thing. I don't want to waste my time, so I want to know it's going to be a success before I begin, and I need to plan it all out. And the difficulty of planning it all out is anytime we begin to plan, the steps just multiply. Like, think about it. If you like to do something and want to do it, like, say, go down to the beach or get on a boat or go fishing, there's a step. Like, one, just go, right? But if you don't like it, how many steps can we make? I mean, I have to get up. I have to get changed into beach attire. I have to take off clothes first and then put them on. This is hard. And then I have to get in my car. But hold on. First, I got to take some water, some sunscreen. Oh, this is too much. I'm done. Like, right? And if you wanted to go fishing, well, then you have to go get your gear. You have to take it in the car. And then you might have to tie a hook. And then you probably have to get bait because all the other bait's moldy and gross and dead. Oh, it's too much. I'm done. Have you experienced any of that ever? Anyways, some people do. But if you really wanted to care, the ultimate, we're in church. What's your ultimate motivation? Anybody? Come on, Jesus. He's the right answer. We're in church, people. So every time we're in church, you should just say Jesus to the answer, and most of the time it'll be right. It's really easy. So, but here's the thing. We're dealing with this whole sermon series on glittering vices, and the year we're talking about being more like Jesus. And I don't think Jesus ever experienced meh. I don't think he did, because he had purpose. He knew why he was here, and he had a great, big, like, world-saving purpose. And the hard part is that most of us don't have a world-saving purpose. We're struggling just to get by with any purpose for most of the days, right? So let's see what Jesus got for me, though. In Colossians chapter 3, there's a great verse, and it's, whatever you do, even if it's sitting on the couch, right? Work at it with all your heart. But hold on, that doesn't require much work. As working for the Lord. And the truth is, if you are meh, and I mean truly meh, and this sermon isn't for everybody because some of us are really meh. I mean, I've been meh. I can describe this well. I don't know if you could tell that already. I've been there where I didn't really care. Hard to be motivated. My question, or my answer to this would be, I don't have a heart. When you're really meh, you just don't care. There's no heart involved. So working for the Lord, not for human masters, I don't have a master. I don't care. Some people feel like that. They get really bent out of shape, and it's not that they're upset or angry or anything. It's gone beyond that. They've lost feelings. They've lost emotions. They're just really meh. I mean, just really meh. So since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward, it is the Lord Christ you are serving. But here's the thing. Inheritances are far off and far away. And really, what am I going to get? A harp and a cloud? I don't want that. I'm not big on clouds and harps. I mean, come on. I know that's a fairy tale, weird, cartoonish picture of heaven, but, you know, anyways. Really, what we want is Jesus to do the impossible, to remove me and my mess and make it possible, right? We want a miracle. We want Jesus to somehow give us everything we need, some incentive, a challenge, a development, a goal, some power, some opportunity, some determination, some support. Actually, we don't want any of that. We just want Jesus to go zap and to make our life better. When you're really at the bottom and you're just bent out of shape, nothing motivates. Whoops, we went one too far. The element of indifference. Nah. it is infused in everything when you get there, when you're really, really down. And so you have to ask, well, what's the opposite? Let's find the opposite. The opposite is interest, to actually care about something, to think about something, concern, feeling, to actually have some sense of a heart. It's kind of like the Scrooge. You remember the Scrooge? His heart grew, except he really cared about something. He didn't want anybody to be happy. But when you're really mad, you don't care about anybody else or yourself or anything at all. So, you know, to feel something is meaningful. Even to be the Scrooge is meaningful, right? So passion, sensitivity, like, ooh, there's a nuance to this, right? Sympathy, like, that's amazing. When you can feel for somebody else's feelings, that's a warmth. Aww. Warm doggies and cats. Some people scroll through dogs and cats all day because they just make them feel good. Well, that's above meh, okay? That's not at the end of the road. You're doing better. Emotion, any emotion, any emotion. And if you're kind of bored, that's still an emotion. It's not meh. It's not at the end of it, because when you're at meh, you're like, I don't even care about being bored. So, care, enthusiasm, like get excited about something. Hate something, love something, do something, right? And this is it. Meh is over there, the blue. Don't care at all. And, you know, happy and angry. And these are generally the emotions that everybody kind of, I mean, we talked about emotions before, where we need to learn more emotions and be a little bit more nuanced. That would be sensitivity. That keeps us from getting to meh when we actually start to work out and be more aware of our emotions. But we really need to have some feeling to get past this whole thing. So how do we do that? Well, if you were really mad, you'd be like, whatever, this slide, I don't care. And here's the thing. This is the epitome of meh. The sluggard buries his hand in the dish, but will not even bring it back to his mouth. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 24. And the thing is, with this, doesn't that just paint an awful, terrible picture? Like, you got up to get to the table. There's something you're in front of you. You're interested in it. Like, you really think you might eat it. But you just stick your hand in it, and you're like, oh, I can't pick it back up. It's just too hard. Oh, never mind. Like, why bother? And here's the thing. Some people have aided and abetted others in this behavior. There's some proverb in China about the guy who, he was so lazy, his parents were going on a trip, and he wasn't a little boy anymore, but they took a cake, like a loaf of bread, if you will, but like a cakey bread, and they made it into a big ring, and they put it around his head, and they said, here, you don't even have to move. Just lift this ring to your mouth so you can eat it. And he didn't. And there's a comedian I listened to the other day that was incredibly proud of his children because they were so lethargic. Their mother prepared for them some food because they were going to go out and have a date. And the mother prepared it and said, just turn the oven on, take it out of the fridge, put it in, and, you know, in 15, 20 minutes, half an hour, I don't know what it was, you're going to have food. It'll be hot and ready, and you can take it out and eat it. So you know what they did? They ordered pizza. Because it was too much work to put it from the fridge into the oven. Instead, they just, you know, delivery. The mother came home, was really angry, didn't know what to do, was really, really upset, and she calls up the dad because the dad's out because he's a comedian and he's on tour. And what do I do? How do I punish them? He goes, well, did they pay for it with their own money? Yeah, well, then I don't think you can punish them. So she says, all right, fine. So they couldn't find any good punishment. So the next time they went away, she did it again. They went out on a date and she prepared some food. But this time she prepared a statement and she lectured them. She said, now look, if you think that you can order pizza this time, you're going to be in so much trouble. Last time I couldn't come up with anything. Maybe I wasn't smart enough. I couldn't come up. So this time you do not order pizza. So they went away. They had their date and she lectured them. I mean, it wasn't just that short. It was long. And they come back and they're like, what is this doing in the fridge still? They said, we ordered Chinese. So, but this is the idea of the sluggard. They're so lazy. They just can't do the easy thing of preparing their own food even, or lifting it out of the bowl into their mouth. It's like you have so much available. Let's be honest. If you want to do anything today, you can get step-by-step directions on Google or YouTube. Now, Nikki has said she will never touch those things, but she will call up her children to do it for her, I'm sure. So, yes, she will. She agreed. So the honest truth is, if we don't want to do a thing, we should just say, I don't want to do it. That's honest. Instead of saying, well, it's too hard, it's too complex. No, there are step-by-step-by-step directions out the wazoo for everything today. And if you want to learn anything, like if you want to learn how to launch a rocket, you can just get some books or watch some videos. There is so much available. You don't have to go to school for most. I mean, if you want a diploma, yes. But you could learn so much today. And it's all available, and that's this. We have so much given to us, so much at our fingertips, and we're like, what's on Netflix? And at the same time, when it comes to church, how about inviting a neighbor to church? How about talking to them about Jesus in a kind, caring, compassionate way? Nah, it's just, what's on Amazon Prime? Or regular old TV, or, you know, maybe I still pay for cable because I'm like that. But here's the thing, fear motivates, right? Because we've seen that in this last election cycle really, really well. Fear, gripping fear, right? The fear of the Lord leads to life. Then one rests content, untouched by trouble. Well, and this is right before the previous verse. Just to set it up, the sluggard should know better because if they fear God. But here's the thing. In today's world, so many people have gotten over God. Like, who cares? Nietzsche said he was dead anyways. And Nietzsche didn't actually say that God was dead. What he said was that we've killed him. That's what he was saying. And in truth, where we're at today in our culture, so many people have just disconnected from God that this means nothing. And the next verse that many of us cling to, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. This is so true, isn't it? That when you really study and you really know God, it changes your heart and your life, and it gives you motivation and joy and excitement, and it takes you out of meh, and it moves you into, yeah, let's go. Let's do something amazing for God. The difficulty is we're still in this world, and we get sucked back in because God's so far away. I mean, when's the last time he really did anything big? Right? And so we say, I can't. I can't. We want to say, I can, and we're trying to get rid of that can't, but it's hard, and it's a struggle. So sometimes we focus on fear, and sometimes you might say, well, give me another motivation, because fear isn't cutting it, because God's too far away, and when's the last time he really smitten anyone? I mean, when's the last time he slammed anybody, right? He hasn't, like, killed anybody dead. Like, some people stand up and say audacious things, and there's no worms in their belly, and they're not falling over, right? So we need something more. All right, so Proverbs 6:6-1, the natural explanation. Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise. I love this verse. When I was younger as a teenager, this was one of the ones that the youth ministers and the campus ministers used to slam the kids, right? Go to the ant, you sluggard, because teens like to sleep. It has no commander, no overseer or ruler, and yet it stores its provisions in summer and gathers its food at harvest. So it's on the ball. It does what it's supposed to all the time. How long will you lie there? This is their favorite verse, you sluggard. When will you get up from your sleep? And this next one, it was quoted to me multiple times. A little sleep, a little slumber, and I did the quoting. I quoted it to myself. A little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like a thief and scarcity like an armed man. But the truth is, if you're at meh, you don't care. Even this, like, I don't care if I'm poor. I don't care if I'm rich. I just don't care. Who cares? Like, what's it matter? I mean, we're all going to die anyways. There's some fancy words for that. It's called existential angst. It's the thing that's so far removed and yet is going to happen, and I don't know what to do about it, but it's just out there, and eventually it will come. And when it does, well, you know, can't really stop it, so who cares? And that will crater you into this mental world of poverty, and it will cause lots of problems. So let's go for bigger fear then. Revelation, that's a great place to go for fear, right? Because I know your deeds, that you are neither hot nor cold, cold nor hot, doesn't matter. I wish you were either one or the other. Instead, because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. Done. God is done with you. Oh, I don't like that. That sounds bad. This is like an old-timey sermon. This isn't a very kind sermon. Well, we're trying to motivate people. We're trying to get them to feel something again, right? You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and I don't need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Now, this might apply to some of us because we've given up on Jesus to some extent. We've kind of went, well, you know, I'm good. I'm good. And that's a spiritual meh. All this time I've been describing the normal, everyday, emotional meh. But let's be honest. Spiritually, sometimes we get to this place where we're like, you know what? I'm just waiting for heaven. I've raised my kids, done all I can for them. I give to the church. I show up for worship. I make sure Andrew gets a little like or something on the Facebook every now and again. Okay. Oh my goodness. Folks, Nikki does not do Facebook, and she will never like anything I ever post. And she said, I'll never get a like from her on Facebook. That was good. Thank you, Nikki. But there is some part of us that gets to a place, and it might not be all the time, but there's moments in our lives where we get to this emotional place where we're like, you know what? Just come now, Jesus, because I'm kind of bored of this and I'm done. And let's just move on. Can I get there now? And if it wasn't too bad, I'd probably just take myself out because, I mean, if I thought that that was okay, I would do it. But I don't think you're all right with that, so I'll just have to wait. But spiritually, that's like not okay. Spiritually, that's just awful. And so let's try to get you to feel something again. Revelation 21:8, this is another famous one from childhood. We used to chant this to one another. Liars go to hell, liars go to hell. Revelation 21:8. You didn't do that? Okay, you should start it now. There's a whole bunch of other things you can replace the liar with. But as for the cowardly, those who are afraid, the faithless, those who don't believe, the detestable, those who are disgusting, right? As for murderers, none of us are, but Jesus said, if you hate your brother, so, you know, that works. The sexually immoral, anybody who's doing anything wrong sexually, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars. That's the one we quoted and sang all the time as kids. Their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Now, that's horrible and sad and pathetic, isn't it? Because if you're really meh, this doesn't do anything for you either. But if you're a Christian, a serious Christian, this should cause you some concern, shouldn't it? This should kind of wake you up and go, oh, what am I supposed to do about this? Oh. But fear, like I said, fear like this doesn't work on those who don't believe, and it doesn't work also on those who don't believe in hell. All dogs go to heaven, and all humans do too, right? And so therefore, it doesn't matter. But let's look at Matthew 5, 10 through 12, our verses for today, and you might be asking, well, how do these connect? Here's how they connect. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. If you're persecuted for righteousness, what does that mean? It means you've got something you're willing to die for, or something you're willing to live for, right? And if you're not a Christian, what are you going to be persecuted for? For trying to save the whales, right? Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. If you're not a Christian, what are you going to have people make fun of you about, pick on you for, say horrible things about you, lie about you for? Because of your stance on some political issue? Because you want to rescue abused animals? Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly, We need to go to the next one. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, that again, for somebody who's really meh, whatever. But if you're a Christian, shouldn't that wake you up? Shouldn't that say to you, you have something to live for, you have something to die for, and you should expect some sense of antagonism from the people around you in your life? That provokes feelings, doesn't it? It provokes emotions of concern for myself, for the safety of my children, for my wife, for all of you, that if we were living on the edge and actually living like Christ in a powerful way, overcoming the politics of today, overcoming the silliness of today, overcoming all the craziness of today, people in the world would look at you and say, who are these crazy people? Why are they willing to risk their homes, their lives, their jobs, and everything for the name of Christ? That's the opposite of apathy, isn't it? Being willing to risk your very life and knowing that it might come true? I can't do that. But you can. You can. You definitely can. Because Jesus sets the bar higher. He says heaven is near impossible. But I've given you my spirit, so that you can. So let's try moving towards relationship, and let's move towards love. Ephesians chapter 2, 8 through 10. These are some of my favorite verses in the whole Bible. It says, for it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And that's the thing, that as Christians, we should be saying, God has something for me today. I might feel meh, but I need to get up. I need to get excited. I need to get dressed. I need to take on this day and get life moving because God has something today for me to do. There is something that I am called to do this day to bless another person, to be blessed by God, to show my relationship to God, to show my relationship to others, to show that I love God and my neighbor. What is it that God is calling you to do? Well, this is where we say the sermon's almost over, but not quite. Hang on. We're going to try to go a little deeper, and we're going to take all of this into a place that might be uncomfortable for some of you. Or it might be something that you feel good about. And the first challenge is this: trace your roots. What does that mean? Trace your roots. Well, if you grew up in church, we kind of just did that. If you grew up going to church, historically, almost every church across the nation used fear, shame, guilt to try to motivate you. It was only recently that people said, no, love. Love and relationship and grace is the greatest motivator. It's only in recent times that people said, no, God's love for you should be the thing that gives you life and energy and also washes over all the negativity of your life. And that's the truth. So when you trace your roots, what does that mean? Well, let's go a little bit deeper. Think about in your regular everyday life and in your spiritual life, maybe go home and write down 5 to 10 times that you had the greatest highs and the greatest lows of your life. Sit down and go back through those stories and write them out with paper and pencil if possible and share them with someone. Relive them. Reignite the flame of anger, fear, guilt, whatever it is, those emotions that you've had before, get them back. And say to yourself, why and how am I going to show my love for God through what has happened to me? And that will motivate you to think about the comfort that you've received by God through others and the comfort that you can give to others. And Paul wrote about that in the letter to the Corinthians. Now, the other is this. If you would like to feel better, Some of you are thinking, like, this doesn't help, Andrew. I feel horrible. And this just feels worse. And here's the thing, it's going to. Let's not sugarcoat it. Anytime you challenge the status quo of your life or of an organization or of a system, pain happens. Pain happens. It's going to not feel good. You're going to have to dig deeper, and you're going to have to work hard to feel better, to live better. But here's the truth. The body achieves what the mind believes. You can do so much more than you give yourself credit for. There are people that are what we would like to think are freaks of nature who are in their 80s and 90s still running, like running. Doesn't matter how far they go, they're running. Some of them are on bicycles and they're riding. And the issue is this, they have said to themselves, I'm not stopping until I die. I'm not quitting until I'm dead. There was a man who was in Japan who was over 100 years old and still a practicing doctor. And his patients loved him because he still read, he still studied, he still worked at his craft. And he only quit going to the office when he could no longer go to the office. And it wasn't but a few months later that he died. And this is the truth of our lives. That when we finally give up, do you know the average man when he retires, if he goes home and sits in his chair and watches TV, it will be 2 years or less and he dies. Isn't that sad? We are called to greater things. And when you finally get to the place, and it might be that some of you are already planning in your 30s and 40s to retire, some of the younger people, because you have a great job planned and you've got all these things mapped out and you're going to invest, and you're going to get to an early retirement and live cheap and simple. But what do you have planned for that retirement? And if you're 60 and you're retiring, or 70 or 80 or 90 like some people, and finally retiring, what are you going to do in your retirement? What are you going to do for God? What are you going to do for your kids and your grandkids? What are you going to do with your life? You're still alive. You need to live, right? So, number two, feel again. And this is the thing. You have to feel again. So trace the roots of your feeling. Go deep into your feelings and bring them back out and live again. Because here's the truth. There's a compounding interest, and that this is like financial as well as emotional. When you just don't care, it perpetuates poverty and the continuous cycle of your heart going downhill into depression. Do you know, did I say this already? Dementia, the leading cause is that you don't care anymore. Like, one of the leading causes of dementia is you're like, whatever. You just don't care. So you have to find something to care about. And then when you have interest, you perpetuate the wealth in your system, in your life, in the people around you, because you're gaining, you're growing, you're challenging. You're saying, what more can I learn? What more can I do? There's still stuff out there. There are people in their 80s that have finally graduated high school. There are some people that are in their 90s that are getting a PhD. What? Yeah, it doesn't matter how old you are. You can continue to learn. In fact, I have a friend who's in China. When he retired as a nurse in Tennessee, he moved to China and started learning Chinese. He is still there. The man is in his 70s, and he's still learning Chinese and studying and growing as a Christian. Isn't that pretty cool? Now, this is the challenge. How do we grow deeper? How do we get more? We have to do it now. The truth is, if you say, well, I'll get to it tomorrow, that's apathy. Every time we just push something off and push it off and push it off. And you might say, well, I don't know how to get started. Here's what you do. This is a silly trick, but it incredibly works. And it doesn't matter how big the task is, you can do it. Like, watch this. You just count backwards. 5, 4. But before you start counting, you say, I'm going to get up out of my chair. But don't do it right now because I'm still not done preaching, and that would be awkward if everybody stood up. But you go 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I'm going to get out of my chair. You get out of your chair. You're like, oh, look, your brain doesn't have a clue what you just did, that it wasn't anything important. You just stood up. But what it does is it triggers this reward system in your brain to where you feel a rush of dopamine and these different other chemicals in your brain, and you feel good. So then you go, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, I'm going to go, before you start counting down, I'm going to go get a drink of water. And you do, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, you go get that drink of water, and then you get that rush. Isn't that weird? Why are we wired like this? But let's use it. If you spent your day counting backwards from 5 and doing anything, eventually you would get to a happier place in your head and in your body because they're connected. And guess what? Your spirit is connected to all of this. You're not a disembodied spirit one day. This is all a package deal. It comes together. And so we want our body and our brain and our whole being to feel good and to be good. That's a part of what it is to be growing up. We'll get to that in later. So faith challenges, last one is grace. We ended on that, kind of, and we're ending on it again. Grace is in relationship. And in relationship, you know it's difficult. Difficult roads lead to beautiful destinations. Many of you have been married for many, many years. And you know that the initial I do is rather easy. All of that stuff of puppy love and then leading to marriage and then will you marry me, and then you get married and then you're, what's the wedding? It's easy compared to the actual marriage. The marriage is like here you are drowning practically, and you're throwing a lifeline to somebody else that's drowning, and you're trying to do all of that, and then kids come along and they stand on your head and you're still trying to swim, right? Like, marriage is not easy if you're honest and you work at it. It is work, but it is a great reward because you have somebody who you love and who loves you, and you care about each other. And in that, that is a great destination, isn't it? It's an ongoing destination that never ends until death do us part, hopefully. And even when that happens, let's be honest, you can still have a relationship with that loved one because you know them so well in your heart that throughout your day, you're still talking to them. And if they were here with you, which I believe they are, they would be saying to you, don't be meh. I love you. I want you to be, yeah, I want you to be excited about life. If your loved ones, your parents even, look at you from heaven and they say to you, hey, come on, what's with this? Get with it. You've got a life to live. Live. It's good. I'm good. You're good. Let's go. Let's live. I think that's what they would be saying. They would be challenging you to get up, to get going, and to get back in it, to get your heart back on fire, to be excited again. Because if they love you, they don't want you moping around. They don't want you sitting on your butt going, well, I miss them. They want you to get up and say, yeah, I miss them. But you know what? There's other people in the world that they want me to love. And I have their love in my heart, so I need to share that with others. Because isn't that what Jesus did? He said to you and to me, I love you. Now go take that love to others. And if your spouse was a Christian, for sure they want you to do that same thing with their love to your children, to your cousins, your neighbors, your brothers, your sisters, their family, right? So this thing is challenging us to go deeper into ourselves and to come back out of that and saying, you know what? There is pain, but it's well worth it. Just the other day, Brittany did an Ironman. Do you know what an Ironman is? Jim and Lynn's kid, Bryce, his wife is Brittany. I don't know if you know that. But anyways, she ran an Ironman. Well, ran, swam, swimming. I thought it was just a mile. It's 2.5 miles or 2.2 miles, something like that. It's a lot more miles than I'd want to do in the ocean. And then she gets out and she goes for a bike ride of 112 miles. And then after that, she runs a marathon, 26.2 miles. I've never swam that far, but I've ridden a bike that far on one day. And on another day, I did a marathon. And let me tell you, that is hard work. And to do all of those on the same day, that's insane. To finish that is amazing. I don't care what place you get, you finish in one day all of those activities. Wow. But that is a zest and a joy for life, isn't it? That saying, I know how hard it is, and daily I am working my butt off to finish a marathon. Not a marathon, an Ironman, which is a marathon and then a cycling marathon and then a swimming marathon. I mean, that's just crazy. And you might say, well, but I'm 60, 70, 80 years old, or I'm 40 and I'm 30 and I'm, you know, I'm not in that kind of shape. It's not about that. It's about your heart and your emotion and your desire for life. What is it that God is calling you to do? What is it that you have been blessed with the ability to do? And what is it that God desires of you to do? How can you show your love for God and your love for your neighbor? And that includes your brothers and sisters here. So let's take all of this, and it's going to be hard because, you know, we just went through a whole bunch of mess right there, right? But let's take all of this and spend some time with it. Let's work on it. And then let's come back thinking about how we can bless others, how we can be sharing the love that we have felt throughout our lives with others. And if you haven't felt much love in your life, well, then let's find a way to bless you. Tell us that. Let us know that you haven't felt love, and we're going to find a way to shower you with God's love like you've never known. Because that is who we are as Christians. We're called to love one another. And if somebody's lacking in it, we want to fill them up so that they are overflowing and able to bless others. That's who we are. That's how God asks us to live. Won't you pray with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Father God, as we continue to pray, we ask that you would wake us up again. That you would bring our hearts back into our lives, that our emotions would be centered on you, that we would learn what it is to have discipline, self-discipline, that if it takes counting backwards from five and getting up, that we would do that all day long until we're in a place where we can do things for you. We know you have prepared great things for us to do, and sometimes it just means sharing some food with a neighbor. Sometimes it just means calling a neighbor and saying, hey, are you okay? Sometimes it's more than that. Sometimes it's donating a ton of money or a kidney even. God, whatever it is you have called us to do, give us a heart to go and do it, to get up, to care, to love, and to show that love for others. God, I thank you for this church. I thank you for this place, this city. God, I ask that our hearts would be on fire for you, that we would be excited about what you have called us to do here and now. May you continue to show us your love that we might show it to others. It's in Jesus we pray. Amen. If there's any way that we can bless you, a phone number available there. You can text, you can call, you can also Facebook me or respond online. If there's any way that we can pray for you, if you need to put on Christ, if you're at a place where you just need prayers or encouragement, or you're feeling down, let us know. Let me know. I would love to pray with you, to be able to comfort you, encourage you however I can. And if not me, then one of the elders or even Jim. I mean, I hear he sometimes can listen to people and encourage them. Sometimes. Anyways, if we can bless you in any way, why don't we do that today? We're going to stand. We're going to sing.
Over all the earth you reign on high, every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you'd reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams, in my darkest hour. More, 'cause you mean more. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? You are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again?
You go ahead and be seated just for a minute. Before Bruce gets up here and brings us the announcement, says the closing prayer, I just wanted to take a minute here, because you know, life goes on. We've had an interesting year this year. A lot of interesting things have happened. It has not been without its challenges. And I just wanted to recognize a couple of people that have kind of helped us through this year. We've continued to be able to meet. We've continued to be able to face some of the challenges that have come about. And so I want to publicly thank some of these people. I want to thank Andrew. Andrew has done a lot. He kind of went from the in-person preaching to being in here by himself preaching to developing a way to do it online and all that. So I want to thank Andrew. And of course, anytime you thank a man, you got to thank his wife, because any challenges that confront a man, the wife bears a large burden on those too. I also want to thank the Fowler family, Keith, Donna, and Doug, who have done a lot to develop our electronic way of putting it out. It's gotten better to the point where Andrew pointed out today, some people may just decide to do church in the future in their pajamas from home. But it's been that good. But I also want to thank Keith for all the work he's done, and Donna as well, and Doug, and even Donna's mom, because Donna's mom has been here and made sure that all the chairs, even when we were outside, had communion on them and everything. So if you get a chance, say thank you to them.
I concur 100%. If you guys would have been depending on me, we'd be meeting out in a field somewhere with rocks and sticks and stuff. But thank you, you technological giants. We have several announcements, and I have a software update. Yeah. I'm not very technical, folks. Please forgive me. You know, I haven't. This is last week. Janice Clark had a shoulder surgery. I haven't heard about that, but keep Janice in your prayers. I hope that all went well. Donna Fowler's brother, Eric Finch, was diagnosed with COVID-19 yesterday. Please keep him and his family in your prayers. Also, please continue to keep Linda Howard's cousin, Margot Kimball, in your prayers. Margot Kimball Lind, her last name is Lind, in your prayers as she continues to battle cancer. And this is from Phil Thomason. Please remember the family and friends of Jack Birch in prayer. He was a well-known preacher, teacher, missionary, and outstanding Christian man. He lived in Camarillo and preached in Burbank until last year. And Phil didn't say this, but I presume he's passed away. So keep the Birch family in your prayers. Keep Florence in your prayers. I was made aware that she's just in a whole lot of pain. She's at home. She can hardly walk. And bless her heart. We need to pray fervently for her. Our Tender Life ministry, we are going to help the home during the Christmas season. They are in need of a decorated Christmas tree to celebrate the season with. We are accepting donations between now and November 22nd to make this purchase for them. So if you are motivated to help the ladies and their babies at Tender Life, talk to Carolyn or talk to me. But, continue to remember the City of Children. We have three dear children down there and a whole bunch of other kids that we love, and they're all locked down still. And continue to remember our Friends Speak program. We continue to get calls on that, and really we're kind of lacking teachers unless folks are willing to do a Zoom meeting just because of the times. But we're meeting with people safely distanced, by the way, and it's working out well. So keep that in your prayer. It really is a great program. Anything else I've forgotten?
No, I guess you could call this a public service announcement.
Okay.
I'm a member of the Methodist Farm Board, and we would like everyone who has an American flag to fly on November the 11th. My dad never called it anything but Armistice Day, but we now call it
Veterans Day. Yeah. Thank you, all you veterans, really. I'm one of them. Yeah. Thank you, Bruce. I'm beside myself. I'm sorry. We need to make light in these crazy, weird times. You know, I'm living in the twilight zone. I can't believe it. But God prevails, and he is in charge. Don't you ever forget that, okay? Let's go to our Father in prayer. Oh, I do? I'm sorry. You won't believe it, I'm at the software update. Oh, Janice just said she is doing well. That's great. Isn't technology great? That is so cool. All right, well, we're glad you're feeling great, Janice. That's wonderful. Let's pray together as we dismiss. Our Father in heaven, we come before you as your humble people, wanting to be servants for you, wanting to be your children, wanting to look to you for guidance and sustenance, for strength, for courage, for purpose. Father, help us. This has been a difficult year. There have been so many things thrown at your people, but all people. And I'm not clear on why all of this is happening, but you are in charge, Father. And when we second guess you, we're destined to not make the right decisions. We need to listen to you. We need to study your word and know what it says. We need to trust you more and more each day, Father. Thank you for Andrew and his message this morning. Help us, Father, to not be blasé, to not just give up on life. Because Andrew is right. Every day of our life, there is something we can do that'll make a difference in this life. And it may be great, and it may be small, but it can make a difference. And help us, Father, to realize we have purpose. And if we do nothing more than bring a smile to someone's face of a day, that's a good thing. Help us never to cut ourselves short, Father, and help us never to just give up. Because you are the God of creation, the God of heaven, the God that made everything that we know and still controls it all. Help us, Father, to know that, to believe that, to trust you. And I just thank you, Father. I thank you personally for being a Christian. Your word touched my life, and I'm not a perfect man. I make a lot of mistakes, but I am such a better man because of you, Father, and I am grateful. I am so grateful. I thank you for my brothers and sisters throughout the world, but I especially thank you for those here in this place that do so much to encourage me. Help me to encourage them as well, Father, and help us all to rejoice that we know you and that you love us and that we can serve you. There is no better blessing on earth than to serve you. Thank you, Father. It's in Jesus' name that I pray.